Well, good morning, Trinity Baptist Church. Let's all stand. We're so glad to see you here this morning. We're glad that you're here. We're going to have a great morning, and I hope that God blesses our services. You know, the Bible says that we ought to let God rule and reign in our lives, right? So sing this song with us called Lord Reign in Me. Let's sing this together. Sing it.
Over every thought, over every word, may my life reflect the beauty of my Lord. Turn me more to me than any earthly thing. So won't you reign in me again? Lord, reign in me, reign in your power over all my dreams, in my darkest.
Church again today, and if you're a guest, we hope that you'll take a moment and fill out one of the connection cards, because this lets us know, number one, you're here, and there's a lot of information we'd like to send to you at times, and if you fill it out, it'll be of a great help there. And if you're watching on Facebook at TrinityBaptistFinley.com, we use these connection cards. There's four reasons that we use them for. One's to connect with guests, and when you're here, it helps us, and you can give as much or as little as you want to give as far as information, but it will help us. You can share with us prayer requests so that we can pray with you about things, and updated information also. We can let you know about different things that are taking place here in the church. It can be of benefit to you in that respect. And so please fill a card out if you've never done that. It'll help us an awful lot to know who's here, and we'll try to utilize it for God's glory. And coming up, Memorial Day, very special day. How many of you have heard Sold Out before saying? They're a great group. They're going to be with us. Wonderful group of guys, great music, and a great message. Invite someone to come with you that day. They'll enjoy it, and you'll enjoy it. And on that day, the 3rd through the 6th grade will be in the auditorium that day also, so they'll hear some good quartet music themselves there. Normally, our kids are in the service on the 4th Sunday, but we want to have them here on the 5th Sunday here. So Memorial Day, we'll also have a very sacred time honoring former members and attenders. It's amazing this last year, all those that went home with Jesus. We all know somebody, and a lot of them from our church did. And we'll take time to remember those members and regular attenders who passed away since Memorial Day of 2019. And so help us honor your loved one by going to the Welcome Center after the service and listing their name on the board that we have there, and we can make sure we let folks know about it on that Sunday. Student ministry camps are going to be coming up for young people, which you young people, it's a great time. That's where I dedicated my life to Christ and surrendered to preach. It's a great place to go just to be with other Christians your age and learn the things of God. And so that's coming up. And check your bulletin. It gives you some things that you can know and how you can register your kids for camp. And kids' choir starts on June the 6th. That kids' choir will begin on Sunday the 6th at 5 p.m. Kids age 3 through 6th grade can be a part of that. And see Dawn Ellett for information. Dawn Ellett, are you up here? Raise your hand there, okay? Touch base with her, okay? And then we have a testimony of a family, one of our missionaries to Tanzania. We have that coming here. And they're going to share some things with us. And it's Nathan and Tiffany Foltz, missionaries to Tanzania. And they write, they said, the Bible study we had going was a great Petri dish of learning for us. But during this pandemic, the families attending have all moved away except for one. Boy, we need to pray for the Foltzes because of that. We're looking forward to seeing how the Lord will lead our opportunities this year. Some creative thinking will be needed, but we want to keep the main thing the main thing. We desire to share the gospel with the lost and focus on the local church. There are some great opportunities of continued discipleship teaching. So if you've been faithful in your stewardship, continue on, not only for what God does in and through this church, but also in churches all over the world. Over 100 missionaries we have as a part of our Trinity family. So keep the folks in prayer that God will bless. Four ways to give: online, with text to give, by mail, or in person. Here we have our offering boxes at the back there. Yes, sir.
I'm here because you guys probably notice that Mike Gentry and Angie are not here with us this morning. Lucas had a seizure this morning at very, very early. They had to take him to Blanchard Valley Hospital. He had another seizure. Had one this morning early and then just had another one. And they are admitting into ICU right now. So we're going to take a minute and pray for them.
Amen.
And pray that God would work in their lives. I'm going to ask Brother Herb to pray for them, okay?
Father, I think back to the time when our oldest boy would have several seizures a day. And it just gripped our heart. I can't imagine what Mike and his wife are going through. I can't imagine what their dear son's going through. Lord, we know that you still tell us to cast our care on you. I pray for Lucas, that you'll give him the right doctor who can do the right job to help that young man through this seizure time. Lord, it's so difficult for everybody included. Young man in this prime of life, and I pray, God, you'd give grace and just enable them to find the right help that he needs. I pray, Lord, for those who love him, mom and dad and others, that, Lord, you'll just strengthen them through this time. They've been up all night with him there. Pray, Lord, you'll give healing. Pray you'll give hope to them. Help us as a church not only be praying for Lucas, but others who go through trials. But Lord, we do ask that you, for your glory, and for Lucas's good, that you'd raise him up. And Lord, it may be just the beginning of a great new kind of a witness that Lucas could have to others. We bless you and ask these things in the name of Christ our Savior. Amen. Amen. All right.
This time.
Thank you.
Amen. They did a good job, didn't they? Let's all stand. We're going to sing a song that's maybe new to some of you, maybe new to the church a little bit. And this song goes so well with the message today. You know, the gospel is found in the cross, and the cross was really about our salvation. Amen. Jesus died so we can be saved. Let's sing about that this morning. Let's go ahead.
Your love for me, that lonely night in Gethsemane, the sinner's heart can't help but thrill to hear you pray, Father, not my will. What depth of love, what reach of grace, oh, how my grateful heart now.
Your weary journey in. Come and lay
Again.
So I'll cherish the old rugged, cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will
If you will, take your Bibles and turn to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 23. We're going to start reading in verse 33. Luke 23 and 33. It's also on the board if you need it. Luke 22, 23, 33. Bible says, "And when they were come to the place, which is called Calvary, there they crucified him and the malefactors, one on the right hand and the other on the left. Then said Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And they parted his raiment and cast lots. And the people stood beholding, and the rulers also with them derided him, saying, He saved others. Let him save himself, if he be Christ, the chosen of God. And the soldiers also mocked him, coming to him and offering him vinegar, and saying, If thou be the king of the Jews, save thyself. And a superscription also was written over him in letters of Greek and Latin and Hebrew, This is the king of the Jews. And one of the malefactors which were hanged railed on him, saying, If thou be the Christ, save thyself and us. But the other answering rebuked him, saying, Dost not thou fear God, seeing thou art in the same condemnation, and we indeed justly? For we receive the due reward of our deeds, but this man hath done nothing amiss. He said unto Jesus, Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. And Jesus said unto him, Verily, I say unto thee, today thou shalt be with me in paradise. Father, we're grateful that we have a home called heaven and a Savior named Jesus. Lord, we thank you that one day there will not be any sickness, pain for those who know Jesus. We thank you, Lord, that there's a better day coming. And Lord, for this morning, we pray that our hearts will be drawn to the cross and to you on that cross to remember what you paid for us. And Lord, there's no payment we can make to make up for that, but we need to present our bodies a living sacrifice for your glory. I pray, Lord, for each saved person here that, Lord, we'll today listen intently as we learn about this Savior we already know, but that sometimes, Lord, we need to hear it again. I pray for any that may be unsaved this morning that, Lord, before they leave, they'll call upon you and ask you to save them. Lord, you want to do that. Now, thank you, Lord, you made that promise on the cross, hanging on a cross. You told a man he'd be with you in paradise. What a God we serve. We pray you bless your people now. Meet the needs of those who are in hospitals. Meet the needs of your people today. Bless our pastor as he opens the word of God to us. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you. You may be seated. This week I asked my wife this question. She didn't like the question because it was my day off and she thought I was working still. People that preach have to come up with things to talk about every week. But I asked her this question because I thought, I wondered if it would make a good introduction. The question is this: if you were given this hypothetical situation, if you were handed a microphone and given a stage and 15 minutes to address the entire world, okay? You have 15 minutes to tell the world what you need them to know. There's a lot of people that would say a lot of different things. right? Some may use that 15 minutes to address economic problems. Some may use their 15 minutes to talk about the environment. Some may use the 15 minutes to talk about love. There's a whole lot of topics you can choose. But when I asked my wife this, and she's got smart brains. She loves Jesus. When I asked her, what would you talk about if you had 15 minutes and everybody in the entire world watching? She said what every Christian, every God-fearing, Jesus-loving Christian would say. And I think she got the right answer. She said, well, wait, before I tell you what she said, what would you say if someone handed you a mic and a stage for 15 minutes to address everybody? In one word, what would it be? Hey, you guys got it right. She said, my wife said, the subject has got to be salvation. Now, some of you said Jesus. You may say the cross. You may say the gospel. And I think all of those are talking about the same thing. Amen? The most important message that we can give is the message of the cross. The message of Christ crucified, buried, risen again for our sins, and having been seen by 500 even at once and all those other witnesses. Amen? That is the message that if you are a Bible-believing Christian, you have to say that's your answer. We see crosses everywhere, don't we? People wear crosses around their necks. You see them at jewelry stores. You see them at graves. You see them on our trip, usually when we're going from Ohio to Missouri, where my family is, right there on, I don't even know what highway it is. I just say to Siri, take me to Springfield, and it does it. But somewhere in Indiana, there's this giant cross on the side of the road. How many of you guys have seen that? I mean, crosses are everywhere. And sometimes I think for us, it can lose its significance. I think sometimes it can become common. We come in every Sunday and we see the cross, and sometimes we forget how important it is. We've been in the book of Luke. This is the 24th message as we've walked through the book of Luke, and Jesus has been marching from Galilee down through Samaria, down into the triumphal entry coming into Jerusalem. He's had that night of communion with his disciples, and he told them that this Passover that they've been celebrating is really about him. It's about his broken body, his blood that would be shed. He said that he would be numbered with the transgressors. He said that he would be arrested by the rulers of Israel, rejected by them, condemned to die, killed, and then he said he would rise again. He told them that before it ever happened. Then he went to the garden, as we sung about this morning, and he knelt and prayed, and he said, God, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me, nevertheless not my will, but thine be done. Then he rose up from prayer. Judas the betrayer came and kissed him. They arrested him. They took him to a illegitimate, illegal trial. They took him before Pilate, who washed his hands and said, after he asked the crowd, what do we do with this man? They said, crucify him. He washes his hands. He tells them to take and do with him what they would, and they scourged Jesus. They beat him almost to death. They take a crown of thorns and they jam it on his head. And he's got wounds across his back. Scourging would almost kill people with just that. And then he's walking up this road, they made him carry his own cross, and there's blood dripping down his face. And he comes to this place called Calvary, and that's where we find ourselves today. Look at what it says here. And when they were come to the place which is called Calvary, there they crucified him and the malefactors, one on the right hand and the other on the left. Here we see the place. It says here they brought him to the place. The word Calvary is a Latin name for the same word as Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. There are some that show us there today. It even looks like a skull, like a human skull. It's where they, what an appropriate place to kill people. So they take him to this place. And we find out not just the place, we find out the purpose. Why did they do it? There they crucified him. Crucifixion was a cruel and punishing form of execution. It was perfected by the Romans. They came up with this idea. When the Old Testament foretold about this coming crucifixion, it wasn't even invented yet. These Romans perfected it. Crucifixion would often take days to kill a person. It was designed to be an elongated torture. People who were crucified not only had the pain of being nailed to a cross, but ultimately they died because of suffocation they experienced being unable to breathe. I read this week. This is not the first time. Maybe you even heard this, but it's a good description by those in medicine of how someone would die. It says, when the wrists were nailed to the crossbar, the elbows were intentionally left in a bent position so that the crucified man would hang with his arms above his head, the weight being taken on the nails and the wrists. Obviously, this was unbearably painful, but it had another effect. It is very difficult to exhale in this position. In order to breathe out and then take in fresh air, it was necessary to push the body up on the nailed feet. When the pain from the feet became unbearable, the victim would again slump down to hang by the arms. A terrible cycle of pain began, hanging by the arms, unable to breathe, pushing up on the feet to inhale quickly before slumping down again, and on and on and on for hours and hours, and for some even days, that kind of pain. And in this passage, we see people. There are a bunch of people there. You see right here at the beginning, malefactors. These are talking about those thieves who were foretold that they would be there, that Jesus would be named among them. One on the right hand, the other on the left. What you see in this passage, Luke is an expert writer. Luke, the doctor, is so precise, but we know Luke isn't the primary author. We know that the Holy Spirit wrote this. And the Holy Spirit, through Paul, as I read this passage, it kind of reminded me, I kind of think sometimes in movies. Anybody ever do this? You have this first scene. You ever do this? Right? You have this first scene, you can imagine through the camera, Luke describing this whole scene. There's this Golgotha, this place, and you have three crosses, and you have these thieves, one on the right hand and one on the left. And then Jesus speaks. And as Jesus speaks, then it goes to several other of the kinds of people that are there and having them say something. We're going to see that in a minute. Verse 34, it says, then said Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. What an incredible statement. The inclination of the attitude of those described, as we're going to see, is at best indifference and at the worst malice and mocking. Jesus' attitude toward them was one of forgiveness. Think about this. He was bearing their sin on himself while they actively crucified him and supported his suffering and pain. They were mocking him while he was giving his life for the one standing right there and for you and me. In quoting Jesus and also the others who were there that believed and those who did not believe, we see the point of Jesus' death. Here you see that I've highlighted in yellow the word forgive. Luke, in under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, gives us the reason and the purpose for Jesus' death by quoting people that hated him. He uses their words against them so that their words would point to what they needed. It's masterful. He is using even those who did not believe to get his point across. The whole scene, the whole circumstance is about salvation. Salvation. It is about salvation. So here's the big idea of the thing. Four statements made at Christ's crucifixion that point to the purpose of Christ's death. We're going to see it this morning. Four statements. Here's the first. It's given by the religious, and what they say is this: if you're the Christ, save yourself. Save yourself. In this setting, we see the response of this declaration of forgiveness in the person of Jesus by seeing other people. The rulers who had been instrumental in arresting him, falsely accusing him, illegally trying him, and getting the people to put pressure on Pilate to convict and crucify him, are now standing at Calvary mocking him. Am I doing something here? Look at what he says. Look at what the scripture says. And the people stood beholding, and the rulers also with them derided him, saying, "He saved others, let him save himself, if he be the Christ, the chosen of God." While he was sacrificing his very life for them, they were talking about salvation. While he was doing what he could do to save them, they were saying, "Save yourself." Religious people have always been concerned with salvation. Some religions are focused on how to be at peace and prosper in this life, but most all of them have had some kind of plan of being okay when you die, and that's really the issue, right? One out of one people die. We're all going to die or go to be with Jesus, right? You're going to die. And what these religious leaders thought was, these people understood that Jesus claimed that he was here to save sinners. They said, I mean, they're bringing it up. Jesus didn't make them do this. They said it, right? He saved others. Let him save himself. And look at what they tied it to. If he be, what's the next word? Christ. Christ is the Greek word for Messiah. What they're saying is the Messiah is about salvation, and salvation can be through the Messiah, but he's not the Messiah. If you are the Messiah, prove it. Now, the thing is, he had already proved it. He had already proved it. He literally was raising people from the dead, and they're like, "We got to kill that guy." If he's raising people from the dead, what he's saying is true. Or he's from Satan, what are they saying? He's from Satan. They were taking part in crucifying him because they refused to believe his identity as God. And this is still the issue today. I'm going to ask you this question. I'm not asking you where you've gone to church. I'm not asking you if you ever prayed a prayer. I'm not asking you any of the, I'm asking you this. To you, who is Jesus? If Jesus is God, then his death means something here. He died for you. Is Jesus who he claimed to be? Does he have the power to save? I think I'm going to go with a handheld. Just to make this day even more loony than it is. They're not the only ones that are there. You see also the Romans. The Roman. What they say is this: if you're the king, save yourself. Look at verse 36. And the soldiers also mocked him, coming to him and offering him vinegar and saying, if thou be the king of the Jews, what? Save yourself. The soldiers said it too, didn't they? The religious said, if you're the Christ, if you're the foretold Messiah, save yourself. They're saying, hey, if you're the king, if you're the one in political power, if you're the one in control, prove it. Save yourself. Doesn't that sound like a Roman? What were the Romans concerned about? They were concerned about power. They were concerned about governing. They were concerned about kings and kingdoms. And the one thing they believed is this: kings have thrones, not crosses. Kings should be on thrones, not crosses. If a king is on a cross, then he's weak. He has no kingdom. I'm telling you this, Jesus isn't on the cross because he's weak. Jesus is the king. And he's going to a throne. He's on the throne now. In their minds, kings should be on thrones and not crosses. This meant that he was not the promised Messiah to them. He was not the king. What they were taking as proof that he was not Messiah was actually the proof that he was. Think about this again. Don't let it land on you lightly. Jesus was dying for them. Jesus was dying for the very ones who were killing them. Isaiah predicted this. Isaiah 53:3, he is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid as it were our faces from him. He was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God and afflicted. But he was what? Wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes, does that sound like crucifixion and scourging and torture predicted thousands of years before it was even here? Isaiah goes on to say, all we like sheep have gone astray. We've turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. What did the Romans say? If you're the king, save yourself. They understood it was about salvation. Isaiah says, yeah, it's about salvation. God is laying on this one in whom stripes we will be healed. He is laying on him the iniquity. What's iniquity? Sin of us all. So look at what they did in verse 38 back in our text. And a superscription also was written over him in letters of Greek and Latin and Hebrew. This is a king, is the king of the Jews. Does anybody see the irony in this? They're putting it up there to mock him, but truer words have never been spoken. He was the King of the Jews, and He's the King of everybody else. And even though it looks like other people are in control right now, Jesus is in control. And the cross is about salvation. The religious, hey, if He's the Christ, save Himself. The Romans, if you're the King, save yourself. There's another one that is brought up. It's the rebellious. The rebellious. There was two thieves on the cross there next to Him. We see this rebellious. I think it's interesting, as you think about the mocking, as you think about the rejection, there's a song, maybe we sung it here before, I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit lives within me because you died and rose again. Amazing love. How can it be that you, my King, would die for me? That leads us to this third person making this statement. Isn't it amazing what all three of them are saying? They really said it. Luke really recorded it. The religious, if you're the Christ, save yourself. The Roman, if you're the King, save yourself. The rebellious, if you're the Christ, save yourself and us. Now, it's interesting. Well, let's look at the passage. What does it say? And one of the malefactors, which were hanged, railed on Him, saying, if thou be the Christ, save thyself and us. I think it's interesting. When He says, save thyself and us, He's not talking about being saved from their sins. He's talking about being saved from their circumstance. There's a lot of people that think about salvation that way. I had a young lady in my last ministry come to see me. She had visited the church. We had followed up on her. She had come back and started coming to our church, and we were praying for her. We weren't sure if she was saved. And I saw her come forward. Someone had prayed with her. I hadn't had a chance to respond, but she called me on Sunday evening and said, hey, can I come see you tomorrow? I said, yeah, absolutely. So she came to my office. And right when she came in, she said, hey, I got saved. I got saved. I asked God to save me, and he saved me. And then she started talking about her circumstance and how that she had this very difficult time. And she started saying about all these different things. And then she said, so I asked God to save me, and He took care of the circumstance, and He saved me. And I said, I called her by name, and I said, can I ask you a question? It's so important that we use the same terms in the same way. I said, can I open the Bible and just show you a few verses? She said, yes. So I walked her through the Romans road. The Romans 3:23 says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. I said, what is that telling you? She said, well, it says that I'm a sinner. So what's sin? Anything that we do that's wrong. I said, yeah, and the things that we should do that we don't. That's also wrong. And then I showed her Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death. That what we earn for our sin is eternal punishment, separation from God, and hell. But the gift of God, it says in the rest of that verse, is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And so I showed her, I said, through Jesus Christ our Lord, and I said, here's the gift. God committed His own love, Romans 5:8, to us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And then I showed her in Romans 10:13, among other verses, whosoever shall call upon the Lord shall be saved. And I said, when the Bible's talking about salvation, and when we use the term salvation, from a biblical perspective, we're not talking about being saved. I said, I've talked to men who said, oh, I was in Vietnam, I was in a foxhole, and I asked God to save me, and He got me out of that foxhole, and here I am today. But that's not the kind of salvation I'm talking about. I said, God can save us from our circumstances, and sometimes He chooses to do this, but the kind of saving that you and I need is saving from our sin. Salvation is about being saved from our sin and its consequences. I called her by name, and I said, are you talking about being saved from your circumstances or being saved from your sin? What happened to you yesterday? She goes, oh, saved from my circumstances. And I said, I'm so glad that maybe God did work in your life, but can I tell you that if you die right now and you haven't trusted in Christ because he died on the cross for your sin, you're going to split hell wide open. She didn't get saved that day, but the good news is she did get saved. But that kind of saving that she was asking me about, that she was claiming to have experienced, is the kind of salvation this guy's talking about. He's saying, I'm kind of noticing you're in the same circumstance that I am. You're on a cross. And think about his breath, right? He has to extend himself, and he is sarcastically, how do you know it's sarcastically? Look at what it says. The malefactor which were hanging railed on him. He's not asking this sincerely. He's saying, come on, man, save you. If you can do it, save me too. You get it? I'm glad that just gave the opportunity for this next one. Getting ahead of myself here. You have the rebellious who says, if you're Christ, save yourself and us. Then you have this repentant who says this. He says, you are innocent. You are the king. Save me. Look at what it says. But the other answering rebuked him. This other thief hears that other thief and says, what are you doing, right? Does not thou fear God, seeing thou art in the same condemnation? And then he makes two statements that I think are absolutely necessary for salvation. The first one is this, and we indeed justly. What is he saying? We are guilty. I am a sinner. If you don't believe you're a sinner, then what do you need saving from? You're a sinner whether you admit it or not, and your sin means death, hell, judgment, separation from God. This guy looks at this other guy and says, don't you understand? We are innocent. And then he says this, for we receive the due reward of our deeds, but this man hath done nothing amiss. What's he saying? He's saying, we're guilty. He is innocent. He proclaimed his innocence. He proclaimed his deity. He proclaimed his own sinfulness. He's saying, and then he says one more thing. He said unto Jesus, Lord, was he saying, you are the king. You are in charge. Lord, remember me. What's he saying? Save me. You're my only shot. He's looking at a man on a cross and saying, you're innocent. You have done nothing wrong. I'm guilty. You're the king. You're my only. How do I know the king? Remember me when you come into your kingdom. You're the Lord. You're the king. Save me. And you know what Jesus said? Today. Today, you'll be with me in paradise. Isn't it obvious that this whole circumstance was about salvation? The religious, the Romans, the rebellious, all show us that it was about salvation. They showed that forgiveness was offered to them, but it was not accepted by them because they didn't recognize Jesus for who he is. This repentant thief shows us how simple saving faith is. We recognize our own sinfulness. We recognize Jesus' innocence, his deity, and in simple faith, we ask him for salvation. And when that happens, Jesus says, today, you will be with me in paradise. Jesus said, he who comes to me, I will in no wise cast out. Paul talked about here too. Will you go to the next slide for me? He says in Romans chapter 10, verse 9, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture saith, whosoever shall believe shall not be ashamed, for there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. For whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. So we have four people. Steve, go ahead and move forward on that. You have the religious who said, if you're the Christ, save yourself. The Roman who said, if you're the Christ, if you're the king, save yourself. The rebellious who said, if you're the Christ, save yourself and us. And then you have this one who walks away forgiven saying, you are innocent, you're the king, save me. And Jesus saves that guy. One day we're going to get to heaven and we'll be able to meet that guy. And how he got saved is how we got saved. Four people, four statements, it's all about salvation. There's one more person that speaks in this text. But what he says isn't verbal. Look at the next verse. In verse 44, it says, and it was about the sixth hour, and there was darkness over all the earth until the ninth hour. And the sun was darkened, and the veil of the temple was rent in the midst. In these verses, you see another person making a statement, but it's not verbally. We see two separate occurrences. Do you see them? You see darkness, and you see the veil of the temple being rent. Now we know that those things were caused, those things happened because someone made them happen, and I want to tell you who made it happen. God the Father made it happen. This was God's statement about the whole scene. First we see darkness. We know that God caused it, because in Mark 15:34 it says, and at the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, which being interpreted, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? You see, God caused it to be dark. It was dark for about 3 hours. Darkness was often a symbol of judgment in the Old Testament. This was evidence when God brought plagues to Egypt. In Exodus 10:21, it says, and the Lord said unto Moses, stretch out thy hand toward the heaven, that there may be darkness over the land of Egypt, even darkness which may be felt. And Moses stretched forth his hand toward heaven, and there was a thick darkness in all the land of Egypt. God also proclaimed future judgment in the Old Testament, characterized by darkness. In Amos 8:9-10, it says, and it shall come to pass in that day, saith the Lord, that I will cause the sun to go down at noon, and I will darken the earth in that clear day, and I will turn your feasts into mourning, and all your songs into lamentation, and I'll bring upon sackcloth upon all loins, and baldness upon every head, and I will make it as the mourning of an only son, and the end thereof as a bitter day. So in this, you see darkness and judgment. Jesus even foretells coming judgment in the future, and in predicting this judgment, he predicts darkness. In Mark 13:24, it says, but in those days after that tribulation, the sun shall be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars of heaven shall fall, and the powers that are in heaven shall be shaken. So when there was darkness here, we see God's statement on what was happening. Paul speaks to what happened on the cross between God the Father and God the Son in 2 Corinthians 5:21 when he said this, for he hath made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. In that moment, Jesus was being made sin for us, and God was judging our sin on him. So Jesus wasn't just dealing with the pain of the physical crucifixion. He was dealing with the pain of bearing the weight of sin and the judgment for sin on the whole world in that moment. He suffered more than anyone has ever or will ever suffer. And point to who he did it for. He did it for me. He did it for you. But that's not the only statement God made. The other thing we see in the verse is that God tore the veil. You saw that? God the Father caused the veil in the temple to be torn. Matthew 27:51 describes this. He says, "And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom, and the earth did quake, and the rocks rent." Notice that the veil was ripped from top to bottom. The only way man could ever even possibly do it is maybe from bottom to top. God did it from top to bottom. This veil was a thick veil. I'm told it was made of a leather, a kind of leather. It's not the kind that you just rip. God had to do it. What was this veil? What was it separating? This curtain, what was it? Well, we know that it was in the temple. That's what it said. The veil in the temple was torn. Hebrews 9:3 says about the temple, and after, where it was talking about, the second veil, the tabernacle, which is called the holiest of all. In the temple, there was the court of the Gentiles. That means anybody could go into it. Then there was the inner. There was another court that Jewish people could go into, court of the women. That's all, any Jews could go there. Then you had another court that only Jewish men could go to. Then you had the holy place that only the priests could go into. And then you had the Holy of Holies. That was the place that only one priest could go, and he could only go in there on one day. And that day was the Day of Atonement. He would go one day a year into that place with the blood of a spotless lamb. He would have a rope tied around his leg so that if he went into that place unworthily and dropped dead because of the holiness of God and his own sin, they could pull him out. He would go into that place and he would sprinkle the blood of a spotless lamb onto the mercy seat, the top of the Ark of the Covenant. He did it to atone for his own sins and the sins of the people. So do you get the picture here? John, early in Luke, we talked about this, looked at Jesus and said, "Behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world." And when that Lamb of God was on the cross, judgment came from God the Father, pouring out his wrath for your sin and mine, making Jesus sin that we might be made righteousness. And when that was accomplished, God tore the separation between himself and us in two. There's like 10 of you that are excited. We don't have to have somebody go on our behalf. Now we can go to God directly. We don't have to have somebody, some lamb, to atone for our sins. The Lamb has already done it. He's already done it. And it doesn't have to happen every year. It's been done once for all.
So in Hebrews, it says, in that second went the high priest alone once every year, not without blood. Meaning he took blood there, which he offered for himself and for the errors of the people. Verse 11 says, but Christ, this is awesome. The Bible is really great. Like, seriously, you should read it. It's like, it's incredible. You should read it. It's really good. It's better than the movie. Like, it's read the book. But Christ, being come and high priest of good things to come, by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. He's the sacrifice. He's the priest. It's all about him. And we can have a relationship with God because he sacrificed himself and mediated between God and us so that we don't have to have any. I can go to God on your behalf and I can pray, but I don't have any more power or say with God than anybody else in here if you know Jesus is your Savior. Peter put it this way. I think it's the next one. But you, he says, are a chosen generation. Oh, I put all those on there. Go to Peter. But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that you should show forth the praises of him who hath called you, here it is, out of darkness, out of judgment, into his marvelous light, which in times past were not a people, but are now the people of God, which had not obtained mercy, but have now obtained mercy. Outside of Christ, we were dead in our sins. We weren't part of God's blessing, but now God has made us a part of his family, and he's given us mercy and an inheritance, and we're going to a place that he's prepared for us, and it's all because of the blood of Jesus Christ. So what did God say without saying a word? What statement did he make? The darkness signified what he thought of our sin and the wrath for sin that he was placing on his son. And the veil being torn signified that the payment for sin was satisfactory. And that now by the blood of Jesus, we can be made a royal priesthood. You know what that means? What did he say? If we're saved, then we're sons. And if we're sons, then we're heirs. And joint heirs with Jesus Christ. His royal blood atoned for our sins. We are his kids. We're a part of his family. We are a royal priesthood, able to come to God. And we don't, what did, you remember what Jesus told the Samaritan woman? There's coming a day that neither in Samaria or in Jerusalem will you worship. You can worship anywhere in spirit and in truth, right? So, two ways this has to be applied. Number one, we have to see our sin how God sees it. Jesus bore the wrath of God for our sin. If we don't trust in Christ, we must endure his wrath forever in a lake that burns with fire and brimstone. The Bible says about that place that we'll be cast into outer darkness. And Jesus put it this way, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. So we have to see what that thief saw. We're getting what we deserve because we're sinners, but this man is innocent. Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. We who are saved can go to God by the blood of Jesus. We can worship him in spirit and in truth. Access to God is now not limited by location. We can go to God whenever and wherever we want. Because of Jesus. And so my question for you today is this. Are you saved. Not are you a member of a church, not are you a nice person, not are you a good person, not just that do you believe that Jesus died for sins, has there been a time where you said, Lord, remember me, Lord, save me, has that happened in your life? You see, four, if you're the Christ, save yourself. If you're King, save yourself. If you're Christ, save yourself and us. But will you be like that last one? God, save me. There was one more statement that was made. It was made by Jesus. Jesus said in verse 46, And when Jesus had cried with a loud voice, he said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And having said that, he gave up the ghost. He decided when it was over. He had already said, therefore doth my Father love me because I lay down my life that I may take it again. No man taketh it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This commandment have I received from my Father. And boy, did he take it up again. He didn't stay in the grave. 3 days later, he rose from the grave. Amen? The cross takes away my sin, and resurrection tells me that God can make me alive again. So where are you at today? Are you saved? If you were to die right now, would you go to heaven? You know, the Bible says, appointed unto man once to die, and after this, the judgment. I have two buddies I went to Bible college with. Josh Adams, Judd Adams, Ohio boys. Josh's nickname was Killer. That's what we called him. Because if you played basketball with them, you'd understand what that meant. This week, I saw on Facebook their 12-year-old niece stepped out in front of a car. The car hit her. She lost brain function. Yesterday, they pulled the ventilator, and she's with, now good news, she knows Jesus. Because of the cross, there's hope. But you know what? You know what? Old people die. Middle-aged people die, young people die, babies die. And when we die in our sin, the Bible says we're separated from God. You are not guaranteed to get out of this service, much less out of this week or this month or this year. The Bible says, teach us to number our days that we may have a heart applied unto wisdom. Bible says that our life is like a vapor that appears for a little while and then vanishes away. And that's not just true of you. That's true of everybody you know. Like, this week may be your last shot to tell your neighbor about Jesus. The cross is about salvation. We have the best news that can ever be told. And the truth of the matter is, to wrap this whole thing up, you do have a stage. You do have a microphone. And it may not reach the whole world, but it reaches your world. Who are you telling the most important message that could ever be given? Who are you telling? Would you bow your heads and close your eyes for me tonight, this morning? Lord Jesus, God, I love you so much. I did not deserve your son. I did not deserve his blood. I did not deserve mercy and grace and goodness, but you gave it to me anyway. May that never get old to us, God. God, thank you for giving us your son. For judging and killing your son for us. Help us to never get over that. And if there's someone here today that doesn't know you as Savior, God, may they not bank on tomorrow. God, would they come today and put their faith and trust in the simple way that that thief did? Just, God, save me from my sin. That they would pray that, not that the prayer saves them, but that acknowledgement of who your son is and what he did, they would know for sure heaven's their home. And God, for that person in here that their heart is going cold about this issue of the cross, maybe they're not as on fire as they once were for sharing this message with everybody that needs it. God, may the truth of your scripture melt our hearts in a way that melts the lead in our feet and the mask on our face. And may our church be a church on the move with the message of the gospel. I pray that today, if someone doesn't know you as Savior, they would respond. God, today, if someone's moved to pray for a lost friend or loved one, that God, that they would not stay in that seat, that they'd come forward and ask you to help them repent of their sin, help them to respond appropriately to the cross. We love you. We thank you for all you do. Would you stand? However God's dealing with your heart, we want to give you a chance to respond. There are people here that can take God's word and show you how you can know heaven as your home. We're going to sing, Now's Your Chance. It's about salvation. Let's do this. Seated. In just a minute, we are going to have a couple of people come and follow the Lord in believers' baptism. If you're here with us today and it's your first time or first time in a long time, we are grateful that you're here. There is a connection card in front of you. And we use those for a couple reasons. One, if there's a prayer request that you have, you can turn that in to us. If you have if it's your first time or first in a long time, it helps us to know that you're here, and we'd love to connect with you. If you need to take next steps like baptism, you can do that. And let us know about that by filling one of those things out. And you can put those in the offering boxes in the back. Baptism, that you're going to see in just a minute. And before I talk about that, let me say this. It is the Sewells' last Sunday with us. Are you guys sad that they're leaving? Would you guys stand? Let's thank them for being here with us. We're going to miss you guys, and it's their last Sunday here. They are headed to Indiana. I was very sure of that. And they're going to be going there, and one thing I appreciate about them, and I've known other churches that they've been in, and I've heard other pastors talk about this family, and wherever they go, even if God doesn't have them in a place for a long time, they find a church, they get involved, and I'm really grateful for people like that. So they're not leaving the Lord, they're just leaving us. But they're going to go and get involved, and I'm excited that they're here. And so make sure you say bye to them today. It's their last day. In just a few minutes, we're going to have a baptism, and it's important for us to understand what baptism is. Baptism is a first step of obedience that people take after they get saved. Baptism does not save anybody. That thief wasn't baptized. And Jesus said, today, you'll be with me in paradise, right? And so he didn't have to do that. It's a good news, too. That would be a rough baptism, wouldn't it? Trying to figure that out, right? But Paul in Romans says that, don't you understand that as many of you as were baptized into Jesus were baptized into death? And he says, you are also like raised in like manner. Baptism is a picture of Jesus' death, his burial, and his resurrection. It is just a picture of that. And the Bible says that if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. The old is gone. The new has come. The good news is that's just Findlay City water. We don't have to get that shipped in from anywhere holy, okay? It's just regular water, okay? But that act of going under and coming back up is a picture of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so what someone says when they're getting baptized is they're saying, I'm identifying with Jesus in his death, burial, and resurrection. I'm also identifying with a body of baptized believers. Amen? And so that's what a church is. It's a local body of baptized believers. So that's what they're identifying with. They're identifying with Christ, and they're identifying with this local church. These two that are coming today have both recently gotten saved, and they're taking this first step of obedience and baptism. So let's see what happens here.
This evening we have two candidates. This morning we have two candidates for baptism. Uriah Yates, do you know the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior? You believe he died for you and rose again. Amen. Uriah, upon your public profession of faith in Christ as your Lord and Savior, it's my privilege to baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, in Jesus Christ. Raised in the likeness of his death. Sarah Duggar, do you know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Mm-hmm.
Amen. It's my privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of Jesus' death. Raised in the likeness of Jesus' death.
Isn't that exciting? Both of those situations, how they got saved, was some family members that cared enough about them to share the gospel with them, to bring them to church, and those people are going to heaven. That's what it's all about. They know Jesus as their Savior. You know, after our services are over, I kind of always feel like the invitation never ends. If you're here and you want to talk about Jesus, like, I will wait. You know, I want to go have lunch, but I'll stay here all day if we need to. Come talk to me. Come talk to Pastor Herb or the Dave. There's all kinds of people here that can show you from God's Word how you can be saved. If you need to take next steps for the Lord, we want to help you to do that, okay? Would you all stand? Thank you for being here this morning. You are not dismissed. You're sent. Have a great day.